Welcome children again to this class, and today we are going to do the third part of the lesson, Evans Tries an O Level. So here previously we saw that the arrangement was being done for the examination that Evans was to appear for, and then the invigilator came, and the invigilator was McLeary. And he came over there with the suitcase, and the prison officer, he checked the suitcase and he found that some things were there. He questioned him about it. So he said all these things are needed for the examination. And then the governor, he phoned from there and he said the examination will begin a little late. And then McLeary, he asked Evans, do you have a watch? He said, yes, I have got. And then he said to him, I'll give you the question paper, I'll give you the answer copy, and then you will have to write your roll number, you have to write your center number, and then you have to write the code, and after that you'll begin your paper, and by 9:20 the paper will begin. And he said, you start writing your paper. And Jackson was there. He said, Stephen said to Jackson that strict instructions have been given to me to look into the examination of Evans. So Evans said, ki if you are going to stand over here, if you are going to breathe over my neck, you'll stand over my head, then how I'm going to do my paper? I won't be able to concentrate, so you better go away from here and I'll do my paper. So then Stephens, he gets out of the cell, and then he says, as you wish, and he goes out. The governor heard the exchanges in the cell, heard the door clang once more, and heard McLeary announce that the examination had begun at last. And then the governor was there on the phone call, and from there he was listening to each and everything, the closing, opening of the door, and then the invigilator McLeary, he announced that now the examination is going to begin. And it was 9:25, and everywhere it was peace and calm, that was quiet, and the paper began. At 9:40 a.m. the examination board ran through, and the assistant secretary with special responsibility for the examination had already started. And it was seen that at 9:40 everything was all right, the exam was going on, the examination had started. And after that, a quarter an hour ago, the correction slip came over there because some fool had forgotten to place the examination package, and could the governor please. And then it was called to the governor, can you send the correction slip, because it wasn't kept inside the suitcase examination package. Then he said, I'll put you straight through to Mr. Jackson in D wing, hold the line a minute. So he said, all right, you be on the line, and then I'll be giving you the slip, and you be there in contact with Mr. Jackson. Was this the sort of thing the governor had feared? Was the phone call a fake? Some signal, some secret message? But he could check on that immediately. He dialed the number of examination board, but heard only the staccato beeps of the line engaged. And it was something funny over there, because the governor, he didn't rang. Some other person with the name of the governor rang from there, and that was the person of Ivan, and he just wanted to check, and he wanted to give the instruction to Ivan's that something means everything is okay and he can run away from there. And when the examination board was called on, only the beeping sound came, and nobody picked up the call from there. 2 minutes later, again The whispering communication was there in the cell. Somebody was talking over there, and McClary's voice was there. He was talking to Evans. "Well, will you please stop writing a wee while, Mr. Evans, and listen carefully. Candidates offering German should note the following correction." And then it was said to Mr. Evans, "You just hold on, don't write." And then he said, "The correction is there on page 3, line 15. The fourth word should read goldenen, not goldeny. And the whole phrase will therefore read zem goldenen loben, not zem goldeny loben." I will repeat that. So this was repeated, and it was said that the spelling is wrong and the pronunciation is this and it should not be the other pronunciation. The governor listened and smiled. He had taken German in the sixth form himself, and he remembered that all the agreements of adjectives, and so did McClary by the sound of things, for the minister's pronunciation was most impressive. And the governor, he was listening, and he said, he smiled because he had taken this German in the sixth standard, and he remembered all the adjectives that were there in there. And McClary's pronunciation was so impressive that he smiled and he was very much happy. But what about Evans? He probably didn't know what an adjective was. And Evans himself did not know. Though he was appearing for the examination, it was just a pretense. So he did not know what the adjective was. The phone rang again, the magistrate's court. They needed a prison van and a couple of prison officers, remand case, and within 2 minutes, the governor was wondering whether that could be a hoax. And then again the phone rang, and the call from there was there that they wanted prison van and couple of people, police people they wanted, because for the remand they wanted to take somebody. And the governor was wondering that this is just fooling going on, and he supposed. He told himself not to be so silly, but then he thought that he's acting silly. So he said to himself, "I shouldn't be so silly." His imagination was beginning to run, and he was imagining that everything was going on bad. Evans, for the first quarter of an hour, Stevens had dutifully peered through the peephole at intervals in 1 minute or so, and after that every 2 minutes. At 10:45 a.m. everything was still all right as he looked through the peephole once more. And for a quarter of an hour, Stephen was looking from the peephole after every few minutes, and then after 2 minutes, and then after words when he looked, everything was okay. And then it took 4 to 5 seconds, no more, was the point. It was always more or less the same. Evans, his pen between his lips, sat staring straight in front of him towards the door, seeking, it seemed, some sorely needed inspiration from somewhere. And he saw Evans always sitting with the pen in his mouth, and he was looking at the door as if he was trying to recall or remember what he had to write. And opposite him, McClary, seated slightly askew from the table now, his face in semi-profile, his hair amateurishly clipped pretty closely to the skull, his eyes behind the pebble lenses, peering short-sightedly at the Church Times. And McClary, he was sitting and he was looking at the magazine, the Church Times, that he had brought with him, his right index finger hooked beneath the narrow clerical collar, and the fingers of the left hand, the nails meticulously manicured, slowly stroked the short black beard. And with the other hand, he was stroking his beard. At 10:50 a.m., the receiver crackled to life, and the governor realized he had almost forgotten Evans for a few minutes. And then at 10:50, when the phone rang, He remembered that he had forgotten Ivan's totally. So Ivan said, please sir, would you mind if I put a blanket round me, around my shoulder, sir? It's a bit braggy, and isn't it? And then Ivan said, ki sir, I want to put my blanket round myself because I'm feeling cold. There is no one on me bunk. Sir, be quick about it. So Ivan's again he said, ki there is no one in the bunk. So McClary said, all right, take it quickly. And then again there was silence. At 10:51 a.m., Stevens was more than a little surprised to see grey regulation blanket wrapped round Ivan's shoulder, and he frowned slightly and looked at the examinee more closely. And at 10:51 a.m., when Stevens he peeped inside, he saw that Ivan's was covering himself with a blanket, and he was looking at McClary. But Ivan's, the pen still between his teeth, was staring just as vacantly as before, and still he was sitting with the pen in his mouth and looking at the looking in the vacant as if he was thinking about the answer. Blankly beneath a blanket, should Stephen report the slight irregularity? And then something was going on inside the blanket, and Stephen thought that he should go and report about it. Anything at all fishy, hadn't Jackson said, and he thought that something is fishy going on over there. He looked through the peephole once again, and even as he did so, Ivans pulled the dirty blanket more closely to himself. Was he planning a sudden Batman leap to suffocate McClary in the blanket? And when the next time Stevens looked inside the room through the peephole, he found that Ivans was pulling the blanket more closely to himself, and he thought that he might suffocate McClary. Don't be daft. There was never any sun in this side of the prison, no heating either during the summer months, and it got quite chilly in some of the cells. And then he said to himself that in this cell, no sunlight comes, and during the summertime also it's quite chilly over there. So maybe he must be feeling cold, that's why he has covered himself with the blanket. So Stephen decided to revert to his earlier every minute observation. Now he decided that he will observe Ivans from there after every minute. At 11:20, the receiver once more crackled across the silence of governor's office, and McClary informed Ivans that only 5 minutes remained. So 11:20, when the bell rang, the invigilator McClary, he informed Ivans that 5 minutes are left for the examination to get over. The examination was almost over now, but something still not away quietly in the governor's mind. He reached for the phone once more, and there was something in the mind of the governor going on. So he went and he picked up the receiver. At 11:22 a.m., Jackson shouted along the corridor to Stevens. The governor wanted to speak with him. Hurry, man. Stevens picked up the phone apprehensively and listened to the rapid spoken orders. 11:22, Jackson, he called out to Stephen that governor wants to talk to you, he's calling you, so you hurry up. And he was listening. Governor was listening from the other side what was being told to him. Stephen himself was to accompany McClary to the main prison gate, and it was said that Stephen should accompany McClary to the prison gate. Stephen's personally was to make absolutely sure that the door was locked on Ivans after McClary had left the cell, understood. And then it was said to Stevens that he should personally check the door of Ivans after McClary left, and he said, you will have to do it, you have your understood. So he said understood. And at 11:25 a.m. the governor heard the final exchange. 11:25 there was the exchange of the answer copy. McClary, he said, stop writing please. Again there was silence, and then McClary, he put all the sheets in order and he numbered them, scraping the chairs and tables. Then the sound of chairs and table was there. Ivan said, "Thank you very much, sir." He said, "Okay." And Ivan said, "Not too bad." So McCleary said, "Good, Mr. Stephen." The governor heard the door clang for the last time and the examination was over. So here, the examination got over and McCleary was now to leave the room. So that's all for today, children. Good day and good luck. We'll continue in the next class.